Hello all, welcome to A Dip in the Deep End, a cybersecurity technical mini-series. I am Shyam Sundar Ramaswamy, lead security researcher. So, what's this program all about? It's just a mini-technical series. It helps you to gain new insights that you take back to work, and you learn from the best technical minds, and all of that in just a few minutes. Today's topic is simplicity is the new complexity. We're going to talk about how the cybercrime evolves and the techniques involved inside a malware or a cybercrime. Sounds really simple at times, but it's also complex. We're going to talk about trending threat patterns, and we're going to talk about how simple these threats are to dissect. At the same time, gradually, how complex it gets to dissect a cyber threat. We also will talk about the new tricks used by the attackers, specifically the complex tricks, and how these tricks delay the investigation for a researcher. Okay, quick primer on what attacks and malware is, just bear with me on that. Cyber attacks are common and complex these days. Cyber attack usually comprises of a malicious code, like simple, when you click on something, it does something nasty. And steals data from your computer or encrypts your computer and so on. So these such type of crimes, when we try to find out what the malware is all about or what the cybercrime is all about, decoding it is pretty hard. So it usually defeats the researchers, and then it delays the reversing process. The more the delay in such process, the more the damage the attack actually creates. And that's the intent of the attacker too. Okay, quick primer on malware. Malware is just a small piece of code. There's no rocket science behind it. Malware is just a piece of small code that does something nasty on your computer. It can steal password, as I said earlier, or it can encrypt your computer. There are like a dozens of like the dirty dozen that you call of malwares, which we would not extensively cover here, but the common types are ransomwares, trojans, keyloggers, scareware, and lots more. It takes various forms. I would say it adapts to the scenario. For example, the most common mistake that a user usually makes is they look for a PDF to doc or like an EXE converter, and that would be shipped or blended or would contain a malicious code because it comes for free. And then there are pirated softwares. When you try to download a Microsoft Office online for free keys, well, that also comes with malware. The key can be a malware too. And then the primary form of all these malwares that come to your computer is either email, which we would probably gonna see in the next coming slides, or even torrents, because you download the free stuff there. That's the primer about malware. And it's the episode one called the handshake. I'm going to talk about the three common infection candidates in this series. Once the document, once the PDF, and once the XLS. Why am I going to talk about it? Because the document, the PDF, and the XLS all are integral part of their lives, our lives, right? And it all comes via email. A document can come in via an email saying, hey, you know what, you failed to pay your insurance premium. Open this document to see if your premium paid is correct or not. The next is the PDF that actually says, hey, here's my resume. Could you please refer me for this job? You never know. You would never would have, you know the person or not, but they send you an email. And third is the Excel sheet. She's like, hey, here's this year's sales calculations, you know, projected. Check on it to see, check it out to see if it's correct or not. So these are the three common infection candidates. And we're going to see in the coming slides what are the techniques used by these attackers to blend the malicious code or hide these malicious codes inside these three forms. And there's also a fourth form that we'll probably see is the EXE, because it's more utility-based. That will be for probably the last part of the talk. Okay, all set. Episode 2, the usual suspects. Okay, you see the cool stuff, right? The cool stuff is always flashy, cool, interesting, thought-provoking at times, very tempting for you to open. When you open, boom, you see the cat, right? The cat's out of the bag. No, the cat's out of the box. When it comes out of the box, this is what actually happens. Consider this box to be a Word document or a PDF or an EXE. Now, how did the cat come out? Because there was a human action or a human intervention here. You opened the box and then the cat came out. The cat's the malicious code here. Similarly, any doc or a PDF or EXE requires a human action on click or double click or open, and then the malicious code comes out. Now that's how it's actually programmed. When you open the document, you get infected. So technically, when you open the document, the code executes. Now how? How does this happen? Document PDFs and EXE have the ability to contain, to store malicious code, because a document can contain macros. Macros are like quick automated tasks that help you to, you know, pull up a chart or pull up a formula, like easy peasy. When you open up, it just runs. And the PDF, it's known to have good graph. It can contain flash objects, URLs, and a lot of these media stuff. Basically, it's a stream. It can contain media stuff that can also hold a code. So the macro in a Word can hold a malicious code, and so does the PDF and the EXE, as you know, right? It's Windows, so it can bind itself. It can also contain malicious code. So what does these contain? Definitely malicious code. Or sometimes the document just contains a link that they make you to click on that link, and then you end up downloading malware. So they can contain dummy content saying, hey, urgent, click here. When you click on it, you doomed. So this is what a document comprises of, or a PDF or an EXE. Let's investigate. Now, we need to see what's inside a doc, learn the intention of the doc, right? Now, if I see through it, I can actually say, oh, you know what? This is what the document's trying to do. Oh, cool, let's save the world. But if I open the document and then I figure out what the document actually does, then you get infected. So we need to find a way, without opening the doc, how can I figure out what's inside the doc? Well, we're going to deep dive into that to see how the malware author has packaged these malicious code, either in a simple way inside the doc or the PDF, or in a complex way. Riddle me this. Now, you need to open, I was just talking about it. You need to tell me what's inside the file and what's the file made of, but you're not supposed to open the file. How do we do it? Here's the classic example. If I look at a car from the outside, I'm actually going to tell about, hey, you know what? The car's got spoilers. The car's got a steering, interesting console. It's got side impact bars, front seat belts, airbags, and whatnot, right? Now, I'm just looking at the car from the outside, just through the window, to see what are the features the car basically has. Now this, in a reverse engineering world or a malware analysis world, we would probably call it as static analysis. Now, if I want to find out the horsepower and the performance of the car, I need to drive the car, right? That's called as dynamic analysis. Now that's the same thing in the document. I'm just going to look through the document and say, hey, you know what? The document, the EXE and the PDF, I know what you're up to without even opening it. So I'm going to look through it. Now, if I want to see what really happens, I have to open the document. That's dynamic analysis, which is driving a car. The driving car is equivalent to opening the doc. Ready to do this? We use a utility called strings. Now strings, I'm going to run it against a file. As I mentioned, it's a static analysis technique, right? I'm not opening the file. I'm just going to look through the contents of the file. Let's take this example. There's a file called 3cron. I got this file via email. I have no idea what it does. But when I run strings against it, I'm able to see that, okay, it uses microphone. It's got monitors. It uses speakers, cut pies, drag and drop. So I figured out that this is actually a sharing app, and it's like a tool that helps me to share the app through a call, video call. It's doing a bunch of stuff. Now I didn't even open the doc, right? It's super useful, right? Let's use the strings against something called as an invoice. Invoice.doc is the most common phishing or the malware methodology used by attackers. Now, I got this invoice.doc part of an email. I'm curious. I need to know what's exactly inside it, but I cannot open the doc. So I run what? Strings against the doc. There you go. When I run the strings, I see a lot of these things that you see on the screen. These are called as Win32 or Windows API, right? Now, in Windows, if I want to open a URL or turn the microphone on or print something or do something, there are a bunch of APIs. So a programmer can actually reference this API saying, hey, Could you, when this program actually runs, could you open the URL? So he uses the Internet Open A, which actually opens a URL. So the attacker is making use of all these Win32 APIs. Now, when I look into it, I see that there's an Internet Open URL, close handle, read, and a bunch of stuff here, right? Now I can figure out that, okay, it's actually doing an open URL. Then there should be an URL inside it. So how do you put the storyboard on? The moment I open this document, the document is gonna contact an IP address or a domain name, and it's gonna download additional malware. What's the evidence for it? I have an Internet Open URL here. Then there should be an IP address. There you go. You see a domain name and IP address. Now you figure out that when I open this document, it's calling this Win32 API to open the URL, and then it's calling a URL. You don't know what it's gonna download, but something super bad for sure. See, we did not even open the document manually, just ran strings to find out the intentions of the document. So these are simple tricks, like super simple tricks used by attackers, and we found them out. But usually it's not the case. I told you, right? The complex part is coming right now. Now, this PDF doc converter exe is a utility that was actually downloaded in Windows to convert PDF to doc, documents. Now, we ran the strings against, this looks suspicious to me, and ta-da, it's all gibberish, right? Super gibberish. Now, in the earlier cases, we were at least able to make out that, hey, it's talking to an internet, it's got something to do with open URL, it's doing something, but here, it's totally gibberish. And you don't know what to do. So that's where you can look up for this called as PE Studio. That's actually a utility or a tool that helps you to do detailed analysis, like a static analysis. Now, when I put this, a file, I just dragged and dropped this file to this PE Studio tool, I was able to see a bunch of stuff. So ignore the rest of the stuff. In the resources, you see actually something called this Auto IT. So when you Google up for Auto IT, it's actually some sort of a scripting language that actually uses. So this, I figured out that this file, you're not able to disconvert.exe contains something gibberish, and that's probably scripted in Auto IT. Now you can put this file in like a disassembler where you can probably want to see what it's made of, but it's a pretty hard task. It's so confusing at times. But what's the clue here? It says the exe contains a script section, so Auto IT script. Now, what I assume here is there's a malicious code combined with AutoID code, and it's combined into a single piece of code, and they would have probably used a tool to convert that AutoID script to exe. So if I give you an AutoID script and ask you to execute, nobody's going to execute it. But what if I give you an AutoID and a malicious code and say, you know what? This is a PDF to doc converter exe file. Install it. Everybody install it. That's the act of convincing. Now, I need to Google for converters. So when we Google for converters, we found out there was an Auto ID converter, and we reversed it back. So we converted the exe back to a script, and ta-da, here we go. Now, this is the tricky game. We are talking about the complex tricks used by authors. Now, imagine when I'm talking about it, it takes a lot of time for me to explain this. Imagine when you investigate the case. This is what the attacker actually wants you to do. Take a lot of time. You spend a lot of time on it. By the time you try to decode it, the infection spreads at a rapid pace. Now, if you observe here, it's all gibberish. This is the trick used by the author. This is the actual code. Now, if you see there's a local, there's a variable declared. In the box section, you see execute. And I figured out that this is definitely a malicious code because it's a variable, it's executing something, and it's got numbers. This is a big, big magic trick. These numbers sometimes are significant. They have a pattern. You need to look into the pattern. Sometimes sometimes it can be prime numbers. Sometimes it can be a divisible numbers. There's a pattern to it. You need to hunt that down. Now, if you observe, the code contains a function. The function actually is called. So the trick for you is a long thing that you need to decode each and every variable to bring it back to normal words so that you understand what exactly the code is. And post some decoding, we found out this is a big process. We found out that this is actually calling a DLL call and doing a bunch of stuff. You know what exactly this was? This was actually stealing some information. When the user installed it as a PDF converter, it started using the Windows resources, and it was actually a keylogger plus stealing information from your computer was sending to the attacker. Now imagine how much of complexity you have to take a pen and a paper, sit down, figure out what it actually does. There's a character combination in it, and then there's a lot more. So the complexity of this attack is you need to look for pattern. The variable name can be puzzles at times. They can be gibberish, dummy words, where sometimes what happens is if you see the WD or FYZ, you need to replace some of the words with the other words so that you form a proper dictionary variable declaration. So yeah, so look for patterns, look for a format. Sometimes it's math. You need to like some whole numbers, sometimes decimal numbers. You need to look for those. Imagine like we saw the most simple, how a file gets dropped in, how do we investigate a file? How much of effort is taken by the attacker to package the attack simple? And you saw the last part where it's like super complex. The cyber world is an ever-changing threat landscape. It increases, the complexity of the attacks increases rapidly. And a lot of people like us researchers constantly fight day in and day out to stop and decode such attacks. I hope this was really useful to you guys. Thank you so much for spending your time on this. Thank you.